Well, good morning. Good morning and good evening, good afternoon to everyone. We'll give it just a minute to let folks come in and then we will start the webinar today. All right. Well, welcome everyone to this NTI webinar. My name is Jessica Bufford, and I am a program officer overseeing the radiological security portfolio at the Nuclear Threat Initiative. I'm delighted to be here virtually with all of you today and to host this important webinar on preventing a dirty bomb, alternative technologies to radioactive sources. So thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule to join us. The webinar today is part of NTI's advocacy to prevent radiological terrorism and support actions that reduce or even eliminate these risks through alternative technologies. To address these risks, governments, the private sector, and civil society must work together to raise awareness about the threat, develop a more robust system of radioactive source security, and replace these sources with effective alternative technologies where possible. The good news is that for many isotopes and applications, there are effective alternative technologies. Thanks to significant technological and research advances in recent years, alternatives have been developed to replace the most widely used and yet most dangerous radioactive sources, such as cesium-137 used in blood and research irradiators. For several applications, alternative technologies are not only safe, but they produce equivalent outcomes. As you know, this is a global challenge that requires balancing the legitimate uses of these materials with their inherent risks. So over the next hour and a half, we'll share information, experiences, and ideas about how to address the growing risk of radiological terrorism and prevent the theft of material that could be used to build a dirty bomb. Before we turn to our panel though, I'd like to start out with a quick set of polls to get to know you, our participants, a little bit better. You should have a poll question that pops up in your screen asking you what sector you're working in, how familiar you are with alternative technologies, and how widely you think they should be deployed. And we're asking these questions to understand you better and also to encourage you to be thinking about these questions throughout the webinar. So we'll give you a couple of minutes to vote before we close it and share the results. So please do go ahead and fill out the polls. We'll be closing them in about 30 seconds. Great. Thank you for submitting your results. And we will be sharing those results later in the webinar today. So just a reminder that as we listen to our panelists, we'll have a QA box at the bottom of the screen. Please feel free to submit your questions throughout the day's event. And we'd appreciate it if you would include your name and affiliation. So I'm pleased that we're joined today by an excellent lineup of experts from the National Academies of Science, the government of Switzerland, as well as two federal agencies within the United States, the Department of Energy's National Nuclear Security Administration and the Government Accountability Office. So first, we will hear from Charles Ferguson, who will provide us with key findings and recommendations from the new National Academies of Science report that was released last June, entitled Radioactive Sources, Applications, and Alternative Technologies and Reactions, as well as feedback from stakeholders since the report's release. His colleague, Dr. Rania Kosti, will join us for the Q&A. Following their comments, Dr. Thomas Fleury from the Department of Home Affairs in Switzerland will share his experience in developing and advocating for Switzerland's national plans to remove and replace certain high activity sealed sources. Then we'll hear from Nick Butler, who serves as deputy director for NNSA's Office of Radiological Security. He'll provide us with an overview of the 2019 University of Washington Harborview incident and discuss policy implications for alternative technologies. And finally, we'll hear from Jeff Barron, senior analyst for the Government Accountability Office. Jeff has overseen several GAO audits on this topic, including one to be released soon. And so he'll discuss security of radiological materials and policy implications of alternative technologies. After we hear from each of our panelists, my colleague Yana Iliopoulos will moderate the Q&A time as we interact with each other and exchange views. Questions should go into the Q&A box, again, as I said earlier, and please feel free to use that function as a way to interact with our panelists. So I look forward to our discussion today and look forward to hearing from each of our speakers. So with that, I'll turn the floor over to Charles.
Thank you, Jessica, for the introduction, and thank you very much for NTI for hosting this event. I am pleased today to talk about the recently completed National Academy study, Radioactive Sources, Applications, and Alternative Technologies. Next slide, please. Well, as Jessica mentioned, I'm Charles Ferguson, and I'm joined by Dr. Rania Kosti. Rania and I were the main staff working on this study, and we supported the committee. After just the first few meetings, Rania took over as the study director and did an excellent job working with the committee to produce a superb report. Next slide. We had an amazing group of experts on this committee, with diverse expertise, diverse background, diverse professional experiences. Especially like to express my appreciation for the chairing by Bonnie Jenkins for most of the study up until early January, when she was nominated to be Undersecretary of State for International Security and Arms Control. And then at that time, Dr. Thomas Kroc took over as chair and did a superb job helping to finalize the report with the rest of the committee. Next slide, please. Well, I think a lot of you on this call know that we stood on the shoulders of giants. About 13 years ago, the National Academies in 2008 released a congressionally mandated study that was sponsored by the U.S. Nuclear Regulatory Commission. The focus of that study was mostly on government actions to replace cesium chloride radioactive sources, especially in blood irradiators and also potentially in research irradiators. And that report helped influence government programs that we'll talk about later and congressional legislation about phasing out cesium chloride blood irradiators. Next slide, please. Well, our current study had an expanded scope, and we'll talk about all the information gathering we had to do to meet the expanded scope. So in addition to looking at categories 1 and 2, the highest categories of radioactive sources, the expanded scope included category 3 sources. In addition to looking at domestic developments, we also looked at international developments, and we especially focused on several African countries, Guatemala, and also gathered information from several other countries and regions around the world. And we were tasked to assess the development of alternative technologies. I'd like to express my appreciation for the sponsorship by Sandia National Laboratories and for the and from the Office of Radiological Security. So let's just take a quick snapshot look at where we were in 2008 and where we are today in 2021. Back in 2008, the interim database from the US NRC showed that there were about 54,000 category 1 and 2 sources. The information we received from the NRC indicates that the National Source Tracking System has about 80,000 category 1 and 2 sources. So there's been a significant increase, and perhaps we can talk later in Q&A why that increase may have occurred. Also note that in 2008, there were increased security controls, and now that's codified in 10 CFR Part 37 to have those increased controls in rules and regulations. Back in 2008, there was the Offsite Source Recovery Program. Now that still exists, and we have the Source Collection and Threat Reduction Program as well. Back in 2008, there was no replacement program for cesium chloride irradiators. Now we have the Cesium Irradiator Replacement Project. I know Nick Butler will certainly talk about that. Back in 2008, there was not active government promotion of alternative technologies. And now NNSA has the role of promoting alternatives. Next slide. We had lots of information gathering to meet the tasking that we had received from our sponsor. We had numerous meetings. They're all listed on our public website. All the presentations are posted on the public website. That's all available for your use. These are all publicly available information. You can see the list of people we received briefings from, including our sponsor government agencies, the IAEA, industry, developers, et cetera, et cetera. It was an amazing group of presentations. And I also note that we had presentations from the Nuclear Threat Initiative. Next slide, please. So how do we define alternative technologies? So in the report, the committee defined it as those primary technologies that do not use a radionuclide as a source. And so we focused on non-radioisotopic alternatives. I will note, however, that the committee received information about India's use of vitrified cesium-137 as a possible alternative that India has developed recently for cesium chloride sources in blood irradiation and also food irradiation. Also note that the most advanced and commercially viable alternative technologies tend to be devices that use electricity to produce electron beams to directly irradiate objects or indirectly produce X-rays for radiation by collision with a metal anode. Next slide. We looked at numerous applications and grouped them in basically three categories or classes, medical, sterilization, and industrial and other uses. And you could read on this slide the different types of applications the committee considered. Next slide. So the committee did look at the 2008 Academies report findings and recommendations, especially on phasing out of cesium chloride. And this committee agreed with that recommendation, but it did not attempt to prioritize any particular replacements and did not take a position that possession of any category 1, 2, 3 sources pose an unacceptable risk to society. And it did not endorse specific technologies or commercial products discussed in the report. Next slide. Here's a flow diagram, looks pretty complex and I don't have time to go through it. I will say that chapter 2 of the committee report does go into this diagram, does talk about the characteristics relevant for assessing safety and security risk. So I encourage you when you have time to read chapter 2 and of course all of the report. Next slide, please. I'll note just a few safety and security events that took place in the last decade that were relevant for this current study. In 2010 in Mayapuri, India, There was an incident that highlighted the risk associated with inappropriate disposal of radioactive sources. We also noted, We also noted that the Fukushima accident did not involve radioactive sources, but demonstrated that a radiological event could have large socioeconomic consequences, even though there are no immediate deaths due to radiation. We also looked at an event in Mexico that happened in 2013, highlighted a risk from transportation. And finally, we looked at a more recent incident at the University of Washington, where there was a category one source, but we released about one curie or less than a category three amount of cesium-137. And that also incurred significant economic cost. And I imagine Nick Butler will probably address this in some more detail. Next slide, please. Well, the report has organized into six chapters, 15 findings and 9 recommendations. And you can read how we framed these recommendations, findings, and chapters. We touched on reframing the categorization system. We looked at the end of life management of the sources, looked at prioritization of funding for research and development to support alternative technologies. We shown that support for equivalency studies for replacing radioactive sources can be very valuable and should be pursued. We looked at research on alternatives to cesium chloride for calibration applications. And we also examined local infrastructure needs in low and middle income countries. Next slide, please. Well, in the remaining time, I'm just going to briefly highlight just a couple of findings and recommendations that might be of interest to this audience. Next slide, please. In finding two, the committee found that US government and the international community have taken actions to strengthen security and accountability of the sources. But the actions focus primarily on the high-risk category one and two sources because of their potential cost deterministic effects. Security and accountability for category three sources has been a lower priority because of their lower potential for cost deterministic effects. Next slide. And finding three, the committee looked at recent modeling analyses of various radiological events and concluded that small radiation releases and small radiation exposures that can cause deterministic effects, below levels that can cause deterministic effects, may have serious and long-term economic consequences. And a safety system that is based solely on deterministic effects may provide an inadequate protection of level protection to society. Next slide, please. And recommendations A through C, our first three recommendations, we focused on the IAEA and the Nuclear Regulatory Commission primarily and their roles and things that they should consider. So in particular, the committee recommended that the IAEA and the USNRC should consider reframing their source categorization schemes around the lines listed. And the IAEA, Nuclear Regulatory Commission, and other organizations should make changes to their security and source tracking guidance and regulations based on the outcome of the reframing. And in parallel, the NRC should phase in tracking of Category 3 sources to the existing national source tracking system. And that would provide a more accurate accounting of the national inventory of these sources and would increase accountability for owning and regulating these sources. And the government should make informed decisions about potential security enhancements for Category 3 sources where these facilities are located. Next slide, please. Well, just also note that we've had a lot of briefings, certainly through our sponsor, the various government agencies, to the IAEA, to congressional staff. And overall, we received positive feedback from everyone that who were briefed. And we have not received any written response or commentary by any federal agency, at least to our knowledge. And we've also been doing several other outreach activities, including today's event. Next slide, please. The report, this was released in around mid-June, as Jessica mentioned. And since then, as of October 4th, we've had almost 1,700 downloads from 92 countries. And almost half of those were downloads in the United States. And we've now gotten a contract extension to have the report translated to the remaining official UN languages. And those will be posted for free on the National Academies website. And next slide. Thank you very much for your attention, everyone. And now we go to the next presenter, which is who is Dr. Thomas Fleury from Switzerland.
Thank you, Charles, very much to hand me over the desk here. I'd like to introduce myself quickly. My name is Thomas Fleury. I work in Switzerland at the Department of Home Affairs, more detailed at the Federal Office of Public Health. And I'm going to show you today what we are doing to reduce the number of high activity sealed sources in Switzerland. Next slide, please. So I'm working with the Federal Office of Public Health. The Office of Public Health is the licensing and supervisory authority for all uses of ionizing radiation in industry, medicine, and research, except nuclear power plants. These are regulated by another department. But this way we manage about 25,000 licenses in this domain, less than 100 of which concern actually high activity sealed sources. And the picture you see is our office building in Bern, Switzerland. So in the heart of Europe, there usually we work if we're not at home as today. So the pandemic forced us to work from home, which works actually quite well. Next slide, please. To give you the scope, the thematic here, Switzerland signed the information circular 910 a couple of years ago in 2016 during the nuclear security summit in Washington. This statement wants says that we countries signing the statement need to strengthen the security of high activity sealed sources. This can be done in different ways. First of all, secure those high activity sealed sources, reduce their number, and promote the alternative technology. On the picture, you see the former president of the Swiss Confederation in this year, 2016, Johann Schneider Ammann, posing with President of the United States, Obama. These goals actually were included in an action plan, which was started last year. Next slide, please. Now, I would like to tell you a little bit about my story here. So a couple of years ago, in 2016, I was mandated to come up with enhanced security measures, actually to come up with a directive stating all the measures that need to be taken in order to secure high activity sealed sources. And I didn't want to reinvent the wheel. That's why I went to different conferences. One of them was in Berlin, where I followed the presentation actually of Mrs. Iliopoulos from NTI. And that was when I heard more or less for the first time the word alternative technology. A little bit later, I met Mrs. Christina Hatcher from the Office of Radiological Security, and I learned about the cesium irradiator replacement project in the United States, and also actually the California's Radiological Threat Reduction Initiative, where the whole University of California decided to switch all cesium devices to X-ray where needed. And I was deeply impressed actually by these actions taken by our American colleagues. So I told myself, why not do the same in Switzerland? Next, please. But unfortunately, we didn't come up with such a cool name as a radiator replacement project. We just came up with the words M4 and M5. These are actually the two measures that we follow now in our action plan. So we want to promote alternative technologies and examine and question a little deeper the justification for the use of high activity sealed sources. Next slide, please. Now let me give you some brief overview about this action plan, which actually celebrates its first birthday next week. It consists of three action fields. I just want to show you the first one, which is prevention. So we want to prevent that radioactive materials are being used for malicious purposes. So one possibility is to secure them. So all license holders need to secure them against theft and sabotage. But the other one is the replacement. So since security is something costly and tedious, it is much better and much more elegant to have this permanent risk reduction by removing those sources and replace them by an equivalent alternative technology. And now I would like to show you what we are doing and why we can actually replace these sources. Next slide, please. Our legislation in Switzerland allows us actually to do so. We have the Radiological Protection Act. Article 8 says that an activity that involves the exposure of people or the environment to ionizing radiation may only be carried out if it can be justified in terms of the associated benefits and risk. And now the Radiation Protection Ordinance in Article 3 gives a little more detail about the justification. And it is said in letter B that an activity is justified if overall for people and the environment, no more favorable alternative is available involving no or lower radiation exposure. Now the point here is that it includes people and environment, which includes also all problems. Let's say it's a criminal, dirty bomb, and so on. Next slide, please. Here I would like to show you our process of handing out licenses. So as I told you, the Federal Office of Public Health manages the licenses of high activity sealed sources. Now, if there is a new demand for a license or the demand for a renewal of a license, we will check the justification of the application that they want to have. So is it on a list of justified activities? If it's on the list, next please. A license can be granted. It will be granted for 5 years. And if the application is not on our current list, we will have to go through a review process. So the license applicant has to show and bring proof that there is no favorable alternative to high activity sealed sources. We will then check, of course, these arguments, give them into consultation also, either national or international experts, if we are not ourselves capable of understanding all the arguments, because it's highly specific. And if the decision at the end is that the application is justified, we will put it on the list. It will be an update on the list. And if it is not justified, next please, yeah, we will start a phase out process. So this means that the conclusion is that there is an alternative technology which exists and which needs to be favored. The remaining thing to check is if it is about a new source, so a new license demand, or if it is a demand for the extension of a currently existing license. So if it's a new source which needs to be imported to Switzerland, the demand will be rejected because actually Switzerland does not produce any high activity sealed sources. So whenever there is a source which is used, it had to be imported. So we don't want to have any new sources in Switzerland. And if it is about a license which need to be extended, we will actually check the threat that nuclide poses and then define a special deadline for the future expiration of this license. Next slide, please. Now let me give you a little bit more details about this threat index and the graded approach we are using in our process. So as I told you, this threat index comes into play whenever it comes to define the new deadline, or also the extent of verification of the justification the applicant needs to provide. So the threat index is a formula or an equation, actually, which is composed here of three factors, three terms. First of all, the nuclide. So as Charles mentioned before, cesium is highly dangerous due to its chemical properties also. So cesium is more dangerous and has a higher threat index than, for instance, iridium-192. Then the activity, of course, comes into play. So the enhanced security measures we put into force concern all high activity sealed sources, which means category 1, 2, 3 IAEA. But here the categorization comes also into play for the threat index. So the higher the activity, desto bigger, the bigger the threat it poses. And at the end, there's a factor for the vulnerability. So we all know that there are high activity sealed sources in very heavy equipment, which are difficult to steal or even to sabotage. But there are also sources which are in equipment that is portable, so mobile devices. And so the threat index will be higher if the device is mobile. And what comes out at the end is that if we're in the red category, we will have an accelerated phase out process, and an extension of a valid or current license will be extremely difficult. In the orange or the green category, also here, if there's an alternative, of course, there's no new sources which are going to be authorized, but an extension of the license for a couple of years is possible if the justification is given. And also here, the process of justification, let's say, is a little less heavy than in the red category. Next slide, please. Now I'd like to give you some concrete examples we have here in Switzerland. So it is about the phase out of cesium irradiators in research and medicine. So mainly isotopes that are used for blood irradiation or biomedical research. And since the announcement of the action plan, we have already a reduction of 80% of these sources. So a lot of them are already removed. Most of them are going to be removed this year, still or in the coming year. And the remaining 20% there, actually institutes using these sources have still to prove that or demonstrate that there is no alternative to their source yet. And I'd like also to highlight that there is no financial support by the government. So we were able to convince actually institute or to not to convince or to show them actually danger that such sources can pose, and also the advantages from, for instance, X-ray devices can have. Next slide, please. The last example I would like to show is the one of a so-called gamma knife. This is a device that is used to treat brain tumors in medicine. Here we are in an orange category, and there is actually one device in Switzerland since a couple of years, and there was a demand for a second device at another hospital. This demand was rejected by us because we had the Federal Commission of Radiation Protection, which is composed also by medical doctors. They said, or they stated, that nowadays it is possible to treat all pathologies that are treated by a gamma knife also with a linear accelerator. So an alternative is given, which leads to the fact that any or no more new gamma knife sources are going to be authorized. So the new demand was rejected, and the current device actually has this special deadline. So the sources that are here can be used until their end of life. And to sum up, in the future, or starting now already, the Federal Office of Public Health won't authorize any high activity sealed sources if there is an alternative technology which can lead to the same result. Thank you very much. And I'd like to hand over to the next speaker. Thank you.
All
Great. Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity to speak. My name is Nicholas Belcher, and I'm the director of NNSA's Office of Radioactive Security, or ORS.
Hey, Nicholas. Your audio is not coming through super clearly. Would you be able to come a little bit closer to the microphone?
Yeah, of course. And if it doesn't work, I can switch to headphones.
Oh, there we go. That's perfect. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. My name is Nicholas Butler, and I'm the deputy director of NNSA's Office of Radiological Security, or ORS. We work with government, law enforcement, and businesses around the world to mitigate the risk of radioactive sources used for medical research and commercial purposes. As we've heard from the previous two presentations, radioactive sources could be dangerous and incredibly disruptive in the hands of terrorists who want to deploy a radiological dispersal device or a dirty bomb. And we know anecdotally that in the hands of a rushed but well-intentioned technician, a radioactive source can be mishandled and lead to the temporary closure of an entire research building. At ORS, one way that we help our partners take advantage of the benefits of radiation while also protecting their organizations and communities from the risks just mentioned is by helping them to transition to advanced technologies that don't pose the same risks as radioactive materials. We also help our partners consolidate and dispose of radioactive sources that are no longer needed, thus eliminating the risk that these sources could be misused in a dirty bomb. If our partners still need radioactive sources because there isn't a viable alternative currently, we help them to keep their sources secure through the provision of equipment and training to law enforcement. Today, I would like to share the lessons learned from an unfortunate handling accident that happened while trying to reduce the risk posed by radioactive sources. In May 2019, a subcontractor for NNSA was removing the cesium-137 source capsule from a disused research irradiator at the University of Washington's Harborview Research and Training Building. As part of our important national security mission, we had previously removed 350 such irradiators from medical and research facilities without any problem. On that day, however, the subcontractor inadvertently breached the source capsule, releasing a very small amount around a curie of highly radioactive cesium-137. Given the properties of cesium and the fact that the contractor did not understand they had breached the capsule, the cesium spread throughout the 11-story building. While the level of contamination never posed a risk to public health, it did result in a costly and time-consuming cleanup. The building has been shut down for 2.5 years at this point, with vital research severely disrupted. The final cost of the remediation of the building is not yet known, but we estimated that it will be around $150 million. And again, this is for approximately one curie of contamination. To remediate the building, most of the contamination on the smooth surfaces was wiped away using household cleaning solutions or removed by HEPA-filtered vacuum cleaners. Believe it or not, you can clean up cesium with a Swiffer mop, and I promise I don't own stock in Swiffer, but I kind of wish I did before we bought so many. There was literally a room full of boxes of Swiffer mop pads. More aggressive methods were used on porous materials. Concrete and brick surfaces were scrubbed or abraded in places or removed as necessary. All equipment with filters, motors, or fans carefully surveyed for contamination. Some equipment was cleaned or had filters replaced, and some was fully replaced. Components of contaminated systems that could not be cleaned, like sections of ventilation systems, drains, insulation, and drywall, were removed and replaced. One major challenge was obtaining physical access to certain building systems, which was difficult at times and destructive to surrounding systems. For example, you can imagine ventilation and plumbing systems that were placed together, packed tightly together behind a wall. In this building, we learned a lot about the construction and operation of modern high-rise buildings. And this is, crucial knowledge that will be effective in future responses to contamination. Throughout the cleanup, NNSA worked closely with the University of Washington and the Washington State Department of Health We're grateful for their partnership in working to fully remediate the building so that researchers and staff can return to their labs. Now we'll talk a little bit about the immediate aftermath of the incident, some of the internal investigations that took place within the department. We conducted a thorough and unflinching investigation into the causes of the accident and reached the following conclusion. The incident was preventable. It was the result of weak and partially implemented processes within DOE and NNSA, Triad, the Los Alamos contractor, and International Isotopes, the source recovery subcontractor. Through removing a source from a source holder in the field with high-speed cutting tools and without positive containment should not have been performed. Recovery of the source could have been achieved without removing the source from the source holder. Three, there was a complex regulatory environment that was not clearly understood by DOE and NNSA or Triad. Number four, the Triad contracting process did not implement integrated safety management for off-site work, meaning work that takes place outside of Los Alamos National Laboratory's boundary. The environmental safety and health hazards for the activity were not reviewed or understood by Triad safety personnel and operations personnel. Number five, the incident revealed weaknesses in several INIS, International Isotopes, field operations, work planning, and control processes. Number six, a lack of separation between safety leadership and corporate responsibilities within INAS resulted in prioritization of mission completion over safe conduct of work. And then the final, number seven, spread of contamination occurred because the potential for breach of the source was not considered or reevaluated when power tools were used, or when additional cutting operations that increased the chance of breaching the source were performed. We've taken corrective actions to improve the deficiencies that I just mentioned above. As soon as the incident occurred, we paused all recoveries that required removing the source from the capsule on site, as was the case at Harborview. We revised our policies, recover sources without removing the source from the source capsule. We recover sources without removing the source from the source holder. Wherever possible, and increase the focus on safety and security for each individual recovery. Prior to the incident, we had initiated a multi-year effort to design a larger transportation container, which is now complete, which allows us to recover more irradiators without a source, again, without having to remove the source from the holder in the field. We've also worked with the NRC to clarify the regulatory environment for recovery operations. And now we'll talk a little bit about the impact on CHIRP. That's our cesium irradiator replacement program. Immediately following the event, we worried that users of similar irradiators might be reluctant to work with us on similar irradiator removals. However, that's not been the case. Through our cesium irradiator replacement program, many users of blood and research irradiators throughout the country are still working with us to transition to X-ray irradiators. X-ray irradiators perform the same function without using a radioactive source. CHIRP volunteers receive a financial incentive for replacing cesium irradiators with X-ray irradiators. Additionally, NNSA removes and disposes of the cesium irradiators. From 2015 until this incident, more than 80 cesium-137 irradiators have been recovered through CHIRP without any major issues. Since the incident, we've actually seen an increase in CHIRP, and more than 100 irradiators have been recovered. This increased interest in irradiator replacement is apparent even in Seattle, where two additional medical institutions signed up for CHIRP, one of which was just a few blocks away from Harborview, and has replaced both of their irradiators in the same year as the incident, 2019. In conclusion, Of all the lessons learned, probably the most important is that cesium-137, even in minute quantities, can disperse and make a large building uninhabitable without an extensive cleanup effort. The bottom line is that we are very fortunate that this unprecedented accident wasn't any worse. While learning some very hard lessons at Harborview, we've carried on with our mission to prevent high-activity radioactive materials from being used in acts of terrorism. We continue to work with partners in the United States and across the globe to encourage a transition to advanced technologies that don't pose the same risks as radioactive materials. For those partners who still need their radioactive source, we continue to work with them to keep their sources secure. Thank you for your time. Now I'll turn the mic over to Aaron from the Government Accountability Office.
Sorry, I'm getting a little bit of light coming in. Danger of doing these things at home. Hello, everyone. My name is Jeff Barron. I'm a senior analyst with the Government Accountability Office. I'm going to provide hopefully some context behind the concept of why everyone is now talking about alternative technologies. GAO's been involved in this work for a long time. I've personally been doing radiological material security work for the last decade or so. And I thought I would provide just some background to the kind of work that we've done and how it fits into an upcoming report that's coming out later this month that GAO is going to release that we did on alternative technologies. Next slide, please. All right, this is just a general overview. Some of you may not know what GAO is or have heard of us. We're an independent, nonpartisan agency that works for Congress. Our mission is basically to be the eyes and ears of Congress. We're non-ideological, we're fact-based. We try to be as fair and balanced as we possibly can. Key point is we're a nonpartisan part of the government. And unlike most of the government that works for the president, we work for the congressional branch. Next slide, please. Okay, so here's what I'll cover. I'm going to start with just the concept of something called a risk triplet, which we've incorporated into our methodology for how we understand the risk of radioactive materials. I'll then go through the three different legs of the risk triplet. The first is threat, the second is vulnerability. I'll talk a little bit about reports that we've put out in both physical security for radioactive materials and then also the licensing of radioactive materials. And then the third leg is consequence, what Nick was basically talking about at Harborview, what happens if the material actually is released through a dirty bomb. And then I'll end just with a little bit of an overview about this upcoming report on alternative technologies, which, as I said, is coming out later this month. Next slide, thank you. Okay, so here we have the risk triplet. This is from a previous report. You can see the GAO number down at the bottom, GAO 19468. So as I mentioned, there are three legs to this risk triplet. It was developed by someone named John Garrick, who actually served on a National Academies expert meeting group for us for a previous report. We've incorporated the concept, NRC has mentioned it to us, and NNSA has mentioned it to us. So it's fairly widely adopted just in terms of a good way to look at risk. And the three legs, the first is threat. Threat is the potential for someone to steal material and cause a terrorist act, its intent. The second is vulnerability. This is how easy it is to access the materials. Is it behind fences and armed guards, or is it in a public facility like a hospital? And then the third is consequence, which, as I mentioned, is what happens after a dirty bomb goes off or materials released into the environment. What's the actual consequence of that? Next slide, please. All right, I'll start with threat. This is the one I'm going to talk the least about, just because a lot of this information is classified for obvious reasons. And also, we don't tend to do as much work on threat as we do on the other legs. But NRC has described to us that there's a general threat in which terrorist groups may be interested in acquiring radioactive material. We obviously agree with that. And then, however, we were recently briefed that current assessments of the threat environment show an increasing interest in using radioactive material to make a dirty bomb. And I'll just leave threat at that. For vulnerability, I'm going to talk a bit more about this. We've done quite a bit of work in vulnerability. We actually started doing work right after 9/11. At that time, most of our focus was overseas. We were looking at NNSA's GTRI program and how they secure radioactive materials in other countries, with the thought that someone might try to steal something overseas and then smuggle it into the US. Around 2010 or so, we started to change our focus a bit and look more domestically. We just became more concerned that, well, maybe someone wouldn't buy it overseas or steal it overseas, that someone would steal it internal, you know, within the US and use it here. So we did a report in 2012 looking at medical facilities. What we found is that some medical licensees are more vulnerable than others to potential sabotage and theft. And then we came up with this term, security weaknesses. And I'll talk a bit more about what we mean by that as we go forward. And then 2 years later, we did a report on industrial facilities. So we were trying to catch the whole group of radioactive materials in the US. And similarly, we found that some industrial licensees face challenges. It's a little bit different in that they were both mobile and stationary sources in the industrial sector. And then also the concept of the insider threat. We also talked a bit about that in the industrial report as well. So that's someone who already has access to radioactive material and then for some reason decides to steal it and use it in a dirty bomb. Next slide, please. Okay, here's just some examples of the type of security weaknesses that we found. This is in an industrial facility. You can see on the left, there's a cesium irradiator. If you look closely at the base of it, you can see that it's on wheels. That was intentional because it's an irradiator that was used for different purposes. And so they need to be able to move it around the facility. Unfortunately, it was also just down the hall from a loading dock. So that seemed like a potential problem. Next slide, please. Okay, so this is in a medical facility. And what we found there was that people were writing the codes to cipher locks on door jams in this facility, which obviously is not a great idea. The RSO actually at this facility told us that he often goes around the hospital with alcohol and cotton swabs and erases these codes from door jams. So that certainly caught our attention. Next slide, please. Okay, this is a well logging facility. And what you have here is you can see there's a number of different containment units. There's about 80 or so containment units here. And the way that the well logging industry works, they use americium 241. The threshold for category two for americium is 16.2 curies. So if you have 16.2 curies of americium, you have to implement NRC's increased security measures. So what's happening in the well logging industry is that they're typically purchasing the americium at 16 curies, 15.9 curies. So they fall just below that threshold, which puts them in category three. And then they do not have to have NRC's increased security control measures, which includes remote monitoring systems and response measures and security inspections, the types of things you would think you would need for dangerous material. And this situation in particular is a little troubling because what happens is that when the material is either not being used or is no longer in use, it still maintains its level of radioactivity, but they put it in these containment units. So as you can see, you could have, you know, 80, you could have as many of these sources as you want, all in the same room. And instead of adding them up all together and aggregating them into a single curie amount, which would require, obviously that would put it into category two and require the increased security measures. NRC still considers this to be co-located and therefore does not require the additional security measures. They treat each of these individually, even though they're all in the same room and the same facility. Okay, next slide, please. So we had some recommendations around these things for the medical report in 2012. We recommended basically that NRC provide more prescriptive measures in terms of how they secure radioactive materials relating to cameras and alarms and physical security measures. And then in 2014, in the industrial report, we made a recommendation regarding this co-location issue that NRC should reconsider the definition of co-location and potentially revise it to adjust for this action where people are putting all these sources in the same room. The first one was ultimately not taken up. They did not provide prescriptive requirements. They did put together a best practices guide. And then in the second one, they did reconsider the definition of co-location, but ultimately decided not to change it. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, so the other side of the vulnerability equation is licensing. So I talked a little bit about physical security. We've also done some work in the concept of purchasing or licensing of radioactive materials. And in 2016, we looked at the way that we ensure that someone doesn't purchase a material domestically. In that instance, what we did is we actually acquired through false pretenses, GAO can do that kind of thing, license for radioactive material. We then altered the license and used this real license that had been altered to obtain commitments to purchase a dangerous quantity of radioactive materials. In 2018, we looked at it internationally. That was looking at how CBP verifies the legitimacy of licenses for imported radioactive materials. And what we found is that some airports are not verifying the licenses the way they should under their policies. Next slide, please. And this is just a flow of how CBP does the verification process. Basically, there's a package, it has information on it that then CBP can pull off to understand that they need to verify the license. They call into an internal CBP a group called LSS and tell them, hey, we need to verify this license. Then LSS can refer to either online NRC databases, if that information exists in the database. If it doesn't exist, then they can call Agreement State specifically to verify the license. Once the license is verified, then they contact the airport again and release the shipment. Next slide, please. So we had some recommendations around this. For the 2016 report, we recommended NRC should take steps to include category three sources in the national source tracking system. This is something that Charles talked about a little earlier. That would allow for people selling material domestically at the category three level to then check if those licenses are legitimate using the web-based licensing system. And then we also recommended that CBP develop a system that better identifies the shipments of greatest risk and revise their policies accordingly. NRC has not yet taken action on that first recommendation. CBP did take some action to address our recommendation regarding their policies and procedures. Next slide, please. Okay, now I'm gonna quickly talk about consequence, the third leg of the risk triplet. You can see this is a situation where something goes boom and then there's a dispersal plume, and what does that mean in terms of affecting us? Next slide, please. So in 2019, we did a report looking specifically at this issue of consequence. In our primary findings, we had a number of them, but I would say the big findings out of this was that socioeconomic effects, including relocations and cleanup costs, and then fatalities as a result of evacuations are the most relevant criteria for evaluating the risk of radioactive materials. Excuse me. Currently, NRC uses prompt fatalities and deterministic health effects as their criteria for their security requirements. We found that the socioeconomic effects are actually the most relevant effects for a dirty bomb. And then we also found, and this goes back to what Nick was just talking about at Harborview, that use of certain radioactive materials at much smaller quantities can cause significant socioeconomic consequences. Next slide, please. And here's what I mean about that. So this is analysis, excuse me, that Sandia put together. You can see for a category one RDD, the socioeconomic impacts are estimated about 30 billion, evacuations almost 200,000. Fatalities from those evacuations are estimated at 1,500. This is from Fukushima data. And then you'll see the prompt fatalities from the radiation is zero. So clearly it's the socioeconomic effects that are the ones that we're most interested in this scenario. What we did in our report was then take this category one analysis and put in a much smaller source, a category three source. And we were surprised to find that actually the impact was similar. So instead of 30 billion, it was 24 billion in socioeconomic impact, evacuation still over 100,000, fatalities in the hundreds, and again, zero fatalities from radiation. Next slide, please. So we have some recommendations that came out of this report. As you can expect, the first is that NRC should consider socioeconomic consequences and fatalities from evacuations as criteria for their security measures. And then the second is to require additional security measures for high risk quantities of certain category three material, and then to assess whether other category three materials should also be safeguarded. And neither of these recommendations have been implemented. Next slide. Okay, so this gets to the end of my presentation. So we have this upcoming alt tech report in October 2020. So as you can see, we've done a lot of work on radioactive material security, and not all of our recommendations have been taken up. And we still see a risk out there. So we thought, well, maybe it's time to look at this from a different perspective. And the Senate and House Energy and Water Subcommittees agreed and decided to put together a mandate in the 2020 Appropriations Bill, asking us to look at, excuse me, at all tech. We had three main areas we were looking at. The first is, what is the potential for adopting alternative technologies in the United States for the six most commonly used medical industrial applications? Unfortunately, I can't get into that in detail because the report's not out yet, but this gives you an idea of our scope. The second is, what are the factors that affect adoption of alternative technologies? This is how users think about alternative technologies and whether they want to move to them or not. And then the third is, what's the current status of federal activities relating to all tech in the United States? Next slide. And that's just some information about GAO, that if you want to contact us or get access to this information. Thank you very much.
Great. Well, thank you to all of our speakers. And before we jump into the Q&A session, which will be moderated by my colleague Yana, we just wanted to share the results of the polling questions, which you can see here. As you can see, most of our participants are from the governmental sector, but we have a wide variety of other sectors represented. There's a fairly high degree of familiarity with alternative technologies. So I think that means that we can spend more time thinking about next steps in promoting alternative technologies. When is it appropriate? And what are some of the challenges that still remained? And there seems to be some consensus around using alternative technologies on a case-by-case basis. And so we'd love to hear more from our panelists about what that might look like. So with that, I'll turn the floor back over to Yana to lead our panel discussion.
Thank you, Jessica, for presenting the survey results. And I want to thank all the panelists today for their thoughtful contributions to the conversation about alternative technologies. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Yana Eliopoulos, and I'm a consultant here at NTI supporting Jessica on the Radiological Security Program. Before we move into the live Q&A, and I would encourage all of you to submit your questions, we'll try to get through as many as we can before the session ends promptly at 11:30 today. I'd like to kick off the discussions and ask the panelists a few questions. So for Charles, Rania, and Jeff, I know you both mentioned some regulatory and legislative steps that should be considered to reduce radiological risks and encourage alt tech. Can you talk to us about what wasn't mentioned in your report or other activities that we can take both in the United States and internationally to support radiological risk reduction? And then for Nick, you talked a little bit about the cesium irradiator replacement program and some offerings that NNSA's Office of Radiological Security is supporting here in the United States. But because we have so many international participants as well, can you talk a little bit about USG federal offerings for international support? And for Thomas, we were very encouraged by national measures the government of Switzerland is taking to phase out high activity radiological sources by 2025. Could you talk to other countries and other regulators who are on the phone today about what other activities, how they can use Switzerland as an example for modeling regulatory actions at the national level to phase out all radioactive sources. Thank you.
Yeah, Yana, thank you very much. I think what I'd like to do is to get Rania Kosti into the conversation. I touched briefly on a few recommendations relevant to the Nuclear Regulatory Commission in particular. But one recommendation I didn't mention was recommendation D on end of life management. Rania may want to address that or anything else of relevance in the report. So Rania, over to you, please.
Thank you, Charles. As Charles mentioned, one of the big themes that are discussed in the report is what happens with end of life management of radioactive sources that are being retired and replaced by non-radioactive alternatives. And the general view of the committee is that unless these radioactive sources are retired properly and securely, then the problem of safety and security is not being solved. We saw that within the United States, we recognize it's a problem here, but we also saw it from the case studies we did in African studies in Guatemala. From the case studies in Africa and Guatemala, what we observed is that a lot of the users there are looking at the US for assistance. So that is something that moving forward needs to be addressed.
So I would say, so I can't speak specifically about the findings of our report yet, unfortunately, because it hasn't been issued yet. But I would say that in general, what we found is you know, it's clear that there's a lot of different agencies involved in this topic. You know, obviously NNSA has the CHIRP program and OSRP and is doing a lot of work kind of on that front. NRC is still the regulator, so they still are the ultimate voice on licensing of radioactive materials. OSTP came out with a best practices guide in 2016. DHS did a review of alternative technologies, I think in 2019. You've got research going on in DOE. So it just seems like there's a lot of different agencies involved with this, and it's unclear exactly who is leading this effort and how this effort is coordinated. So that's one thing that, you know, it's just obvious to us that you just have a lot of different agencies currently involved in addressing this, and maybe it's not as coordinated as it could be.
Nick, did you want to provide a little bit of response on DOE and NSA offerings for alternative technologies for our international participants?
Yeah, so earlier, you know, we mentioned the CHIRP program, right, which provides kind of two incentives, money toward the purchase of the alternative technology, and then money toward, or really we just do it, we pick up that disused source that we've now created and take it away and dispose of it. So we have those two incentives. Internationally, we're doing the same things, right? We'll pay an incentive to give someone an X-ray irradiator, for example, and we'll also pick up that source, usually taking it to an in-country consolidation facility, so we can try to shrink that risk footprint from, you know, five hospitals to one central storage facility. It's much easier to secure. We'll then work with the regulator to ensure that their security systems are adequate at that facility. We're also working with international partners like the IAEA, giving them money to help, for example, in cancer treatment. Can we find a way to both help the world sort of cure or treat cancer, but have them do that not with using a radioactive source, but rather using an alternative, using a linear accelerator? So that's one thing we're doing. We also work with our sister office within NNSA, the Nonproliferation Research and Development Office, and that's really looking through. We have an alternative for blood irradiators or research irradiators. What are those other technologies that may be coming down the pike that may be being developed for a non-proliferation purpose? They may be being developed for a pure science purpose. And this kind of gets at what Jeff was talking about. There's no, you know, alt tech is a huge space, right? There's people developing alternatives for science reasons, you know, superconducting Linux. There's other people developing technologies for non-proliferation, like our sister office. You know, for an office that's really looking at just that RDD prevention aspect, we're really the only ones that sort of look across all these different organizations and try to say, how can we get rid of these hurdles? How can we bring new technologies to market? So we'll actually help new manufacturers that are developing a technology come to market and bring their, for example, there's one company that's bringing to market a new research irradiator using a flat panel X-ray. So we've helped them take that from sort of theoretical research space into an application that a hospital or university could use in their research. So we're also trying to invest to make sure that those technologies, there's more options for users, and that would benefit users anywhere, right? In the US, it would benefit users in foreign countries. And so we're really trying to figure out what are those hurdles for alternatives, the greater acceptance of alternatives, and then attacking it from all those different angles.
Thank you. And we'll make sure we put up some links with where participants can find more information about these programs and offerings. Let me turn to some live questions that came in. One is from Dr. Jacob Kamen from Mount Sinai Hospital in New York City. He said, he asked the question of whether the U.S. Nuclear Regulatory Commission is evaluating a justification principle clause for encouraging alternative technologies. I know we don't have any NRC panelists here today, but perhaps one of the speakers could answer based on their expertise on whether the U.S. government is currently considering including justification for license applications, new license applications, given we've seen a 30% increase in sources since 2008.
Maybe I can answer that question. Of course, I'm not part of the government, but I can answer it from our experience talking to the Nuclear Regulatory Commission when we were conducting our study. what the message that we heard is that the NRC does not see its role as a promoter of alternative technologies. And if a user can provide sufficient information that they will be using the source safely and securely, and of course comply with everything else that the NRC is requesting, they would be granted the license.
Thank you, Rania. I also have a question from Dmitry Kovchogin, and he would like to know what the impact of replacement is on typical oversight, licensing, and inspection burdens for operators. When you switch from a gamma-based device to X-ray, you're not outside of regulations, you still need a license. Can anybody provide a brief overview of what those requirements are when you migrate from one technology to the other?
Well, I guess I can give just some general thoughts on this. In the United States, there's the Part 37 security requirements, which are for Category 1 and Category 2 sources that are on the 16 radioisotopes of greatest concern. So if you have material on the list at the Category 2 or above level, then you're required to have additional security measures in place. And these can involve setting up a response from law enforcement to monitoring the material to ensure that it is not being stolen, and securing it to make sure that people can't get in to get it. So all these things have to be in place. On top of that, NNSA has provided additional security measures on top of that in places that have high-risk radioactive materials. Obviously, if you switch to alternative technologies or a licensee switches to alternative technologies, they no longer have to keep this security infrastructure in place. So depending on the licensee, that can be a benefit potentially. In that they no longer have to maintain this and pay for it and things like that.
Thank you, Jeff. We have a question for Dr. Thomas Flory from Daniel Umbran. He would like to know how Switzerland convinced users to switch to alternative technology without government funding.
Okay, thank you for the question. So first of all, actually, I guess the users realize that there's a risk of cesium, having cesium in their cellar. And also, of course, there's a burden by these additional security measures that needed to put into force. And actually, it was starting from this year that they had to realize these increased security measures. So we informed them already couple of years ago that it will be coming, that the security measures come into force at the end of 2021. And until then, they still have the choice to replace their device by an alternative technology which actually works. So if you have the decision between one machine and another, the one or both achieve the same goal, one does not pose a risk, neither a criminal risk or an incidental risks, be it a fire or something else, then the decision was more or less just common sense. And also the day will come sooner or later that the sources will have to be removed. And we saw that the costs of removing sources increase every year. So it will become more expensive to remove a source the later you do it.
Thank you. We have a question from Rusty Lorenzen from Boston Children's Hospital. He asked several questions, but to conserve time, I'm going to just cherry pick the two. He wants to know what the regulatory status is on any actions that would move towards requiring financial assurances for cesium sources. Perhaps Rania could answer that one as well. And whether there will be any federal funding available to conduct side-by-side comparative studies to assist or incentivize the community to move towards alternative technologies.
Thank you, Yana. I'm not sure if I can provide a complete response to that. At the time of the writing of our report, the committee makes a comment that the current financial assurance required by the Nuclear Regulatory Commission is not sufficient to carry out the costs of decommissioning the sources. And I'm not aware of any progress or NRC's response to the Academy's recommendation to increase the financial assurances. I think somebody from the NRC would need to provide an update.
Mm-hmm. And we meet with the NRC about every quarter. And last time we met, the answer that we got was that it's currently before the commission. So to vote, decide what action they should take is before the commission. But the staff didn't have an estimate as to when the commission would move out on that particular paper. And then as far as the funding for comparison studies, that is another thing that our office pays for, is we'll do comparison studies on all kinds of different things. It could be on irradiating medical components to find out if the medical component that was previously sterilized with a gamma irradiator, a large cobalt panoramic irradiator, if that product is still sterilized, if it's irradiated by another modality, an e-beam, for example. And so we do studies, we are doing funding studies right now on that. Again, all getting at this goal of trying to find whatever the barriers are to moving toward an alternative, where can we as a program apply some dollars there and try to overcome that barrier. We're not, this alt tech, there's a lot of reasons people develop technologies that could be replaced with radioactive sources. And they do them for a lot of different reasons. So what we try to do is to just stay aware of what's out there. And then if there's a possibility that there's a hurdle there, can we invest money and try to make information available to put this information out in the public space, so that users can make the decision to move toward an alternative or not.
Thank you, Nick. I have a question from Ari Sayanto from NERA in Indonesia, and I hope I interpret the question correctly. Maybe I should direct it to my National Academy of Science colleagues. He would like to know whether the effort that NAS undertook focused on radioactive materials, the highest activity radioactive sources. Did the NAS study only address category one or two sources, those materials with long half-lives and high radiotoxicity, or were other radioactive materials considered as part of the report of lower category? I know there are a lot of recommendations for category three, but did the report cover the entire category is defined by the IAEA code of conduct, or was it just the highest activity radioactive sources?
So as Charles noted, it was the highest activity category 1 to 3 sources. So this was the statement of task that we were given by our sponsors and the National Laboratories. In chapter 6, where we cover the industrial applications, there is some discussion about category 4 sources. Mm-hmm.
Thank you for the clarification, Rania. I have a question from Chris Boyd, former New York City Commissioner for the Department of Health and now part of Mark Strategic Solutions. He'd like to know whether the rapid rise in the number of Category 1 and 2 licensees, is there a breakdown by industry or sector? So it's more easily, you can more easily determine what percentage of licensees have viable alternative technologies in the marketplace. Charles, you put up a slide that showed the number of licensees. Do we have further information about what sector those licensees represent?
Not quite the kind of detailed information that the questioner is asking for. And I think Rania could provide some background and some of the thoughts from our committee as to what could account for that roughly 30% increase over the last 12 or 13 years.
Thank you, Charles. Maybe I can start with the clarification that the increase we saw was on radioactive sources, not necessarily on the number of licenses of radioactive sources. In fact, if I remember correctly, the NRC told us that the number of licenses has not increased. Again, the NRC is in the best position to provide an analysis of where what sources have increased and from what sector. What the committee concluded is that most likely it comes from industrial sterilization, because this is the application that has been increasing the most consistently within the US and globally. And if I remember correct, the rate is something like 7% per year for the past decade or so. So most likely it comes from there. Possibly some of it can be explained by medical applications like stereotactic radiosurgery.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Rania. I have an interesting question from Kingsley Ahukanya, who's a tactical commander with the CBRN unit in Nigeria. And they would like to know whether there's any reference material for what type of standard operating procedures are available, maybe international standards or SOPs to respond to a radiological incident, whether it's a malicious incident or an accident.
And I can answer that one. We do, when working with our foreign partners, we do work specifically with law enforcement to help them understand the threat that they would be responding to. So both from a radioactive contamination perspective, and then also from threats in the country, risks associated with the material. So we do have some sort of standard plans that we provide to our partners to help them develop their own plans. Each country is different based on the particular threat in the country, the capability of the response force. And there's a lot of sensitive national information when countries build these plans, but that is something that we help our partners to develop.
Thank you, Nick. I'm gonna turn it over. I know we have a lot more questions and I wish we had more time, but we're getting to the end of our session. So I'm gonna turn it back over to Jessica for some concluding remarks so we can close promptly at 11:30. Thank you, everyone.
Great. Well, thank you, Yana. And thank you again to all of our speakers and to our participants for being engaged and asking very interesting questions. I think as you heard from the conversation today that there are certainly a number of advantages to pursuing alternative technologies. Cesium-137 is a particularly good candidate for replacement by alternative technologies, but there is a whole range of technologies that are available. It is also important to acknowledge that radioactive sources still play important roles in our lives. And so when we still need to use them, we need to ensure that they are sufficiently secured to facilitate their use in peaceful applications. So if you have further questions, please feel free to reach out to us or any of our experts via email. We would love to keep this dialogue going. And with that, I'll just close by saying thank you and have a good rest of your day.
Thank you, everybody.